everyone, it's Lynn from WisconsinGarden.com, and today we're going to be taking an early September garden tour. We haven't spent a whole lot of time in the garden lately because our weather is just so bizarre. It's nothing terrible like in other parts of the country with hurricanes and things, but this is probably the hottest summer that we've had. And very little rain, but when it starts to rain, it comes down torrentially, lots of lightning, lots of thunder. And then like yesterday afternoon, after that happened, I thought, well, maybe we'll have a nice amount of rain that fell. It was just a little over half an inch. Better than nothing, but not our usual summer. So we've been staying in more because it was just too hot for us in the 90s and humid. And there's been another reason we've been staying a little bit more restful is because my dear Richard has been suffering, and we think it's from dehydration. He spent a couple of luxurious days at the hospital, and while his tests all seem to be coming out normally, he just doesn't feel quite right yet. He's getting stronger, but it's not quite the same powerhouse that he has been. So you'll see some of the places in our yard that perhaps need attention. We're working as fast as we can without overdoing ourselves. Now yesterday we were able to get out in the morning before the rain came, and it was still kind of humid and it was just kind of muggy out, high 70s, almost 80. But we did do some picking. So we've been very blessed by this weather because the tomatoes are doing well and the cucumbers are doing well and our zucchini squash has done well. I can't say the same thing for my butternut squash, but look at this. This is tomato berries.
That's just from yesterday.
That is from yesterday, and we have given many, many, many away and enjoyed many, many, many ourselves.
Well, you give bagfuls away.
I do.
All of a sudden, I'm in the living room kind of resting, and I see people in the front porch walking home with bags of tomatoes.
Well, sure, of course. And I've already canned 7 quarts of tomatoes for our own use, so that's good. The part that's bothering me is my butternut squash. This is not the normal size for butternut squash, and yet the plants are pretty much done.
I thought that was one of your baby gourds.
I know, it does look like one, but it isn't. This is butternut squash that usually is about this big. And like I said, the weather has just been very strange, and you just deal with it.
Oh, even your zucchini. I know you had bush zucchini this year,
yes,
which
I
don't particularly care for, but that's my preference. I mean, if you saw it right now, we're about to dig it out completely.
Well, I've cut it way back because, of course, powdery mildew is here. The weather is, it's in transition. Let me put it this way. The garden right now is in transition from flowery, flowery summer to getting ready for fall. And we want to show you something else that we are soon going to be taking out. We have a little quiz for you. I want you to take a look at what's in the trailer right now, just the top layer, because I've been cutting things back. Does that look familiar to anybody? Now you may think, well, maybe it's bindweed. Close. These are morning glories that, if you turn around, Rick, and look, there they are. Now, of course, it's not morning anymore, so they're not open. They are gorgeous when they're open. I mean, look at that. They're absolutely beautiful. But then you look down. This is not beautiful. This is taking over.
And these are annuals.
Yeah.
Supposedly,
yep.
Were annuals.
No, they're over here. They're there. They're there.
They're on your Baptisia. Taking
they're
over.
On the ground.
Look behind you.
Yes. They're everywhere. You see this? And you start pulling one place and you get a whole handful. Look.
Oh, I am so happy we planted Morning Glories.
Now, I will say that it's these purple ones that have taken over. We planted, one year we planted, I want to say 4 to 6 different kinds of Morning Glories, and they were true to their life as an annual. They were beautiful. Winter came. They did not come back. These purple ones are very hardy. Let me put it that way. And because of that, they are able to just get farther and farther each year.
I mean, they're already in the strawberry patch.
They're in the strawberry. They were all the way into the squash. So they crossed the strawberries and got into the squash. Hmm. So not only do we have these Morning Glories, we've got its twin brother, the bindweed, that's covering over all of my peonies.
I couldn't believe it when I came out this morning. I thought I would test myself, just, you know, a little endurance. Yeah. I had 3 monstrous handfuls.
Yes, bundles.
Of Morning Glories. I mean, I couldn't carry anymore, and they were streaming all the way from here back to the trailer.
Right. Now, if you look at the ground, all these little black spots here, these are seeds.
Oh, great.
Yep. I remember last year after we took them down off of the trellis, I carefully swept up all the seeds and put them in a garbage bag.
Obviously, you missed too many.
That's why we want to start now and get rid of the blossoms that are still here. It'll be a shame because they are so beautiful. But,
I mean, it is an impressive archway, but my goodness, the price you pay for it is questionable.
Obviously not worth it. This took me probably an hour and a half to get all of the Morning Glories off the arch and into the barrel. Now, that doesn't account for all that's left on the ground.
Or the seeds.
Or the seeds that I'm going to sweep up. Or the ones that are still over there, and the ones that are in the garden.
Oh, I love Morning Glories.
They are beautiful.
Next person that asks me to grow them, please don't.
Well, and then there's, on a different topic, all of that greenery that you see that's outside the bed, that is all straw that has sprouted all along. And then all of that yellowy flowery stuff, that's wood sorrel that I have taken out of there 4 times. I can't even imagine what would have happened if I hadn't taken it out the last 4 times, but I'll take it out again.
Well, it's a never-ending battle.
Yes, it is. Thank goodness we like it.
Please. No more Morning Glories.
Yes, we'll try to get them right away next year because you know they will come up again.
No kidding. Even though they're annuals.
And don't even look over there.
Oh my goodness.
And look, they're trailing along the ground now. And over there.
Yucky.
You might have seen our August tour where we were talking about the hibiscus and how beautiful they are. And as they're supposed to, they went through their blooming cycle and now are mostly just the plants themselves. There are still a few lingering ones like this Luna, the swirl, the pink swirl one. And that beautiful one there, which we thought was ice candy. Was that what we decided that one was?
I don't remember anymore.
Okay, and then this was the beautiful deep, deep red one. We got one left. And he That was open yesterday. So this will be the end of that one.
You know, when I looked at this, I thought, the deer have been up here. But then I realized that the blossoms fall right off the stem.
They just fall off. But you can see, like, over here where the blossoms used to be. You know, and then you look inside and you think, oh, maybe we have seeds. But this one might. Most of them do not have seeds. Most of them are sterile. They don't develop seeds that are viable. Now, then we have our white one. Now these...
This is a giant hardy hibiscus.
Right. Now this definitely has seeds in it. And there are some years when we have actually found little babies growing in the ground. It depends on, everything has to be just right. The temperature, the ground moisture, whatever, the sunlight. So this actually this year is smaller than it normally is. But when we started out, we knew it was going to be tall and we knew it would be wide. But when we divided it and planted some of the babies that we had and put them next to the free book library, which you can now not see, they just took off even more. So when you're planting something, you just kind of keep in the back of your mind, it's not going to be small forever. This is one of my very favorites. This is Jazzberry Jam. And it was later. We knew it was going to be later than the other ones. And this is what we were been waiting for. Now,
and this doesn't seed as well, so.
No, this does not. You may wonder what in the heck is growing over there. And if you haven't seen it before, this is supposed to be a kiwi vine. And it's supposed to be producing grape-size kiwis. Our neighbor down the street has one, and his, now and again, all has grape-sized kiwis that look and taste just like a regular kiwi. Our vine has been really happy this year. I mean, it just goes on and on. It's reaching out, trying to get all over everything, but I have not seen one flower on it.
You have one clematis blossom.
Oh, yes. There
up at the top.
Yep. Well, there's some more over here, actually. But I hate to see the hibiscus go, because they are just so beautiful. But I know, everything has its time.
Well, let's go over to the free book library and see what needs to be done over there.
Yes. What's wrong with this picture? Can I even get a door open over here? Can I get them closed? So when we planted these, we thought we had them back far enough. And then we put cages around them last year to kind of hold them into place. Well, when they started growing and growing and flopping over, when we had one storm and they were flopped way over, I had to start tying them up. And that's not how they should be. They should have their own space that they can get bigger.
Well, even the grass is getting rather invasive in there.
Yes.
So as small as they were when we planted them, it's obvious that we have to rethink where these are going.
Right, because when we had this grass in another area where it was a little bit shadier, it never got taller than this. And now if you look at it,
it's up to your shoulders.
Yes. So that definitely...
Heck, some of it is up to your head. Top of your head.
It is in the back.
Heck, even higher.
So we'll enjoy these hibiscus a little bit longer, and then come spring, probably, we'll start moving them around.
Oh, you can tell school it out.
Yes. Tomato berries are indeterminate tomatoes, so they just keep on growing up and up and up. And you can see all the blossoms of the ones that still want to grow.
Well, you can even see the clusters that are growing right now.
Yes, and here's another beautiful green cluster right here. Now, normally, and we've always talked about this, tomato berries do not split and they do not fall on the ground. Well, this weather has been so hot and so horrible, and then the mosquitoes became so horrible that, yes, they are cracking.
And falling.
And falling. Cracking and falling. So while we need to come out and pick these, and that would help a lot, up until today, it really has not been pleasant to be outside.
At least there's a breeze today to keep these mosquitoes at bay, because they are vicious.
They're bloodthirsty. And it's the females, remember that.
Ooh, those naughty females biting me.
We wanted to show you the fig tree. Now, the fig tree is supposedly, we're right on the edge of freeze zone for the fig tree. It's supposed to be good until up to zone five. And first year got chewed off, and the second year it did better, but this year it's flourishing. I mean, it's just such a beautiful leaf and addition to the garden that you can't help but like it. And look at what else is interesting. Look at the shape of this leaf. And then look at the shape of this leaf.
Like
to me, that's, it's remarkable.
Are you sure this is the same plant? This one here?
Well, sure, because look at the stem. It's the same.
Yeah, the stem looks similar.
Uh-huh, it does. So we don't know much about figs, and we'll probably have to do some more research. And then behind the fig is our Korean maple. Now that's been harmed a bit by all of the lack of water, and we have watered it, trying to keep it moist enough. I guess we need to have a little bit more because it's getting a little crispy on the edges.
Well, the sun has been terrible this year. I mean, it's been so hot, beating down. I mean, I look at the ferns and they're
done.
They look like somebody brought a blowtorch over here.
Yes.
Amazing.
Yep.
But at least
the rhododendrons, at least this guy is looking good. And these are next year's blossoms right here.
Yeah.
And yes, Tim, I will be putting down more muir acid just to sweeten up or sour up the soil. I don't know. I guess it's not sweetening it. It's becoming better. That one always has a problem. This one struggles. So I just need to do more with this one.
Well, like I said, we haven't been out very much. At least I haven't been out hardly at all this summer compared to summers in the past.
Right?
I mean,
yeah. Now I was looking at our Montauk daisies to see are the blossoms even forming yet. And I'm guessing they are just beginning. Now these are ones that bloom the very last in this freeze zone. They will have the beautiful white daisy with the yellow middle, and they're just very happy.
Well, for those who haven't seen our former video, keep this plant in mind, because what do?
In the spring, you go down, and this one needs to be trimmed back a lot. You go back down, and I'm going to be going down to about this, about 6-8 inches. And I will cut it off here. Now, by the time I do that, this will already have little buds starting on all of the little points of the stem. Then I take that stem and I pull off the bottom leaves and stick it right into the ground. Could be in a pot, could be in the soil, and it will become a new plant.
You grow pot? Container. Well, let's show them what happened with your cuttings.
Yes. Some of you may have seen these containers when we were just planting them. These are all plants that we started just by snipping off the top and sticking them in the ground. And you can see the blossoms are forming on these even more than that other one. These, when we put them in here, were maybe this tall.
Oh, you just took the little tops of everything and stuck them right in.
Yep. So we thought they needed to be in more sun, but we were experimenting, hoping that this would be a good place for them. Obviously it was, because I think they're very happy.
Very happy.
But this is a part of the garden that I didn't want Rick to be showing, but I suppose everybody has their parts. These are my squash. These are the butternut squash I was telling you about. And look at how small they are there. I mean, this one is a better example of what it should look like. But I want you also to note what's here.
Oh, goody. More morning glories. Oh, I'm so happy we planted morning glories. You know, one of these days I'm going to have to learn to say no, because I know people want us to plant this and plant that.
And we're happy to do that.
I mean, I am, but...
experimenting, and now, you know, now we just know we've got to get after them before they get too rambunctious. But then we've got spaghetti squash. We've got what I want to say is sugar teeny squash. That's that kind of orangish one with the stripes. This year our delicata never came about. So next year we'll just have to be sure that we have more than one area that we have delicatas in.
And I saw you had one little, well, you have a bunch of them in here.
No, I've got a bunch of big ones
that
in here.
That need to be picked.
Yes.
Soon.
Yep.
But we haven't even been in this garden yet.
Well, I have, but you haven't.
No.
Yeah.
The kale is doing
kale
wonderful.
Is good. We should probably be making some kale chips.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm. And our Swiss chard is good. Thanks to Ranjit. Now these, are you going to show these ginkgo tries? I think we showed when we planted these ginkgos. These were sprouts coming up from the bottom of the tree. And we think it had so many sprouts because it had been trimmed back. And when a tree feels like it's in danger or it's, you
threatened.
Know, yeah, it starts sending up shoots to make sure that it'll come up next year. So when I dug these off of the main trunk, none of them except this one had any roots to it. I thought, well, maybe if I put root tone on it and we keep it in a shadier place, but make sure it's watered enough, they'll make it. I don't know that even this one will make it, but it does have a new leaf up here.
I'd say this one of all of them, and I said this when we planted them, had the best chance of survival,
right?
Because it was smaller. Didn't have all those leaves that try to support the energy.
Right, and it did have a little root on it.
Yep.
So that makes the difference. So I will take this pot, I will sink it into the ground before the first frost, and it'll stay in its container until next spring, and we'll see. We wanted to give Edgar a heads up on what's happening with the plumeria that he sent us. Late last fall, I believe it was, he sent us from Texas two beautiful plumeria plants that he had grown in his greenhouses. And when they got here, they had leaves. And after we potted them and kept them under our sun lamp, all the leaves fell off. Every last leaf was gone, and I told him, I'm sorry, I think I've killed them. And he said, no, just keep watering them and keep them under the plant light, and they will come back. And sure enough, they did, and they were doing wonderfully. And then one day when I looked at them, I saw that they had spider mites. And I thought, oh no, spider mites. I didn't have spider mites anywhere else in the house, and how these got it, I don't know. Well, went to the plant center, got some spray that was supposed to be for indoor plants, and sprayed them, and sure enough, took care of them. And I thought, oh, wonderful. About a month went by, and I looked at them again, and there they were back again. And by this time, it was nice out. So I thought, I am going to take them and put them on the back porch. And then if I need to treat them again, I'll do that. Well, this one was doing very nicely, and it seemed to be okay. This one was not happy, and it was starting to drop all its leaves. So I thought, well, what am I going to do? By now, it's warm enough for them to be outside under this tree. And I sprayed them down with the garden hose. And that's one of the ways you can get rid of spider mites and white flies and aphids and stuff. So I have been spraying these off, keeping them watered, and These leaves look nice. I don't know what's going on with these leaves. So, I'll be moving them back in, and they'll be isolated. We'll see what happens. This is how our coleus looks at this time of year. Now, I've been trying to keep it pinched back so it doesn't get long and leggy. And I've tried to keep it from going to flowers because then it also will get longer and leggier. But, like we said, we haven't been able to get out as much as usual. I'm just happy I got to keep this watered well enough that it's doing nicely. These caladiums are beautiful. This one actually had a flower. If I could see it somewhere. No, I don't see it. There's another one over there.
It's gone.
And then this beautiful little plant is an annual. I just thought that was an absolutely beautiful plant.
That's what Hippo Red.
Mm-hmm. And it's whatever that is. Likes the shade. There is a flower on this one over here though, Rick. This is what their flower looks like.
Do those produce seeds?
They probably will if the season is long enough.
Mm-hmm. And we'll have to keep our eyes open on that one.
Yes. We've been very pleased with our water feature. It's nice and clear. There's one, remember we had that one large goldfish that made it. All the rest passed away back to fishy heaven. But that guy is now at least this big.
I'd say he's close to 5 inches.
Very happy. I don't know what we're going to do with him.
Well, I couldn't figure out what he's eating.
Well, he's eating algae. And if there is mosquito larvae, which I'm sure there has been, he's been doing a great job keeping those from turning into mosquitoes. Our elephant ear experiment, once we raised it up high enough, seems to be doing very well.
Look at the roots.
It's smaller, yeah. And there's the roots.
And there we go too. That's amazing.
Now come fall, we'll move that one into the big pond and it should be able to survive for the winter. Now the ones that we replanted, they didn't want to come up.
There it is. Or she.
Yep. It is a biggie. And very happy. What, the camera shy? We never gave him a name.
Well, maybe we'll have to bring him in for the winter.
Anybody
definitely
want
be a lot easier to catch him here this year.
Oh, yeah.
Last
there we
year,
go.
Last year we couldn't even get anything out of here.
No.
Well, we did when we tore the waterfall apart and got rid of it.
Right. And then our elephant ears behind in the containers doing well. They aren't as green as they normally seem to be, so even though the soil we put in there was supposed to have nutrients in it and we had compost in there, I think they're not struggling, but they're not as large as they have been in the past, and they're not as green.
I am amazed, though, by these Montauk daisies. I mean, mm-hmm. those, when, remember when we had them in little pots, little 4-inch
right.
pots?
Yep.
And they then we transferred, I think I put 2 or 3 pots full in each of these. Now, I mean, these can be propagated from
yes.
here and
oh,
stuck
definitely.
Back into the ground again.
Yes.
They'll just get fuller and fuller
so
and fuller.
These will be full of white blossoms in a couple of weeks.
Yeah. Well, we haven't been able to use our picnic deck
no.
at all this summer.
No, I think maybe we used it once or twice.
Probably while we were building a waterfall.
Probably. But over here we've got more coleus. These I grew from seeds. And they finally got big enough to transplant and live safely. This was one we bought. This is a very pretty one. The balloon flowers have just gone on and
they're
on
light this
and
year
on.
Back here
they are, I think, because of
the
shade.
Shade.
They get
yeah.
more shade. This is a chrysanthemum that we've probably had 20 years, ever since we did the backyard. The plant itself looks very healthy, but they don't last long. Hmm. You know, they go from really cute
little buttons
to this in short time.
I thought we had lost them.
Yes, several times we thought we had lost them, and they keep coming back. They are really tough, but they're not as outstanding as...
You know, I have to say, adding that water pump in here has made a huge difference. So, and I'm glad we did that.
Yeah.
Just have to clean it up every now and then.
Right.
More coleus?
More coleus, and then some perennials that we had started earlier.
Including these perennials.
Yes.
Aren't those wonderful?
You want to have a few for dinner?
No. I hope never to see another one in my lifetime.
Oh, come on.
No.
Now here is our other Montauk Daisy, probably the mother of all of them. And here they go.
Yep.
Now this one I've hit a couple of times with the lawnmower, so that one's my fault, but... Moon lilies or angel lilies, some people call them devil lilies. They pop up in your garden where you don't expect them because I think something carries the seeds. These are the seed pods. They're prickly. They're like little porcupines. And I think it's the squirrels or the chipmunks kind of move them around. So while it wasn't here last year and we didn't have any for a couple of years, suddenly, here it is. I had read that they open up in the evening time, and that's when they are fragrant. And I've never come out in the evening time because mosquitoes. But this year, I made a special
appointment. Or you have heat stroke.
Yeah, or that. I made a special point of coming out the other night, taking pictures, and also smelling them, because they said they have a beautiful fragrance. To me, they smell like lilies of the valley. So wonderful, lovely smell. And as many of our garden plants are, these are poisonous, so you don't want to have your dogs chewing on them or your little kids.
There's one blossom open over there.
Yes.
They are a trumpet, for sure.
They are definitely a trumpet. And they'll last only one day. So it's kind of like the hibiscus. It's there. If I come out in the morning, they're already closing up, and then a new one will blossom. Oh, look, more tomato berries. Now, we picked in here yesterday when it was still warm and not pleasant, and the mosquitoes were around. So the ones that are here are pretty well picked and up to date. So we did find a bunch, and we were in a hurry, and so I just kind of put them over here that I'll be cleaning those up, but just loaded with tomato berries.
Well, your dwarf tomatoes this year are actually starting to produce green clusters.
Yep. These are finally turning red. I'm trying to think. Brandenburg is that one. This one.
Well, I think you had, 14 different
varieties?
Different dwarf tomato plants that you grew from seed.
Yes. And not all of them are tiny like this. And they tell you this one is an indeterminate one. This one is more determinate. So this one will stay smaller. You see the tomatoes are more like in a clump, and here they are just individuals. This was planted by birds or
squirrels
or chipmunks. Again, here's another dwarf, and they are, and look at that, it's coming way down. You can barely read it anymore. But
look at the size of that tomato in there. Oh, that's two of them.
When I thought we were going to have baby turkeys, I kept my guard, my
netting.
My plastic netting around them so that they would still be there instead of being eaten off by turkeys. So I can release those. Again, those are more dwarfs in the back.
And this is going to go.
I suppose, yep. This is the zucchini. I've already taken out the yellow one. Although, look at this. It's starting again. So I might just remove most of it. Those are dwarf back there. These are dwarf. These two guys, they took forever to get big. And they finally were big enough for me to put outside. They have tiny little tomatoes, but whether they bloom or not, I don't know.
What would happen? Maybe we have to experiment. I think we have to dig one of these up, put it in a container, and bring it at least in the back porch, and maybe keep in our little indoor greenhouse.
Yeah.
And just see what happens.
It depends on how big they get. Eva was just asking me if she could do that with a couple that we gave her, and I don't know. We've never done that. It's worth an experiment. Why not? This little area is where I have chased out rabbits 3 different times. So my golden beets that I had great thoughts for chewed down several times. My carrots, same thing, got chewed down until I figured out where the new hole was. This was my my Japanese cucumber. Shinto kiwi, Shinto kiwa, cute.
Shinto.
This was a beautiful one. I like this one a lot. It stayed crisp, and no matter how long it got, it doesn't get fat. It stays slim, and it's tasty. It doesn't get bitter, and the seeds never get big.
Now, you're going to save some seeds from them, right?
Yes, I have them marked already.
Okay.
And then finally, our green peppers decided that they were finally going to start.
You should go in there and get those two uppers that are there. Another one over there.
Yep.
There's another one. No, on the other side.
Oh, yes, that is a whopper. Holy moly. And there's another one over there.
Yep.
You ran out of hands.
Yes. You'll have to carry that one in. That's a nice size one, too.
Mm-hmm. But it's taken all this time, this entire summer, for these guys to grow. Thank goodness our daughter Lace had some and shared with us. Our experiment with Canadian thistle seems to be working. We have now kept this covered for, 2 months?
Oh, easy,
maybe?
Yeah.
And
since we're able to get out here and
pack
these things.
And we peeked underneath to see what it looks like. Everything under there is nice
crisp
and dead. And that's exactly what we wanted. Then we noticed that this area and that area over there, they were kind of popping up over there. So today we covered those up. So
that was exhausting for me, just doing these two little areas, huffing
and
puffing.
Well, I was thinking you overdid. But,
well,
here
I think
are.
I've had heat stroke twice this summer, especially that last one. You were at the garden center or volunteering at the Wilson Center, and I was working on the front of this just to the right of me along the roadside, and I didn't think I was out here more than maybe 2 or 3 hours. And
in 90 degree humid weather.
When I got in, our daughter Lace said I was just huffing and puffing for the longest time.
Right. I got home and she was concerned about you at that point. And then the last 3 weeks have been a second bout. So hopefully now that it's cooler and somebody maybe can pace himself a little bit better.
Well, I'll try.
Thank you. We thought you might like to see what our Japanese maple looked like after it spent the summer just growing as a bush. And I think it was pretty healthy, pretty happy right there, considering all the weather. The birds have planted the sunflower. There were a number of them in here, but this is the remaining one. And I look out my kitchen window and I can see yellow goldfinches taking out the seeds, which is wonderful. Marigolds, I don't even remember if I planted those this year. I think I did, but who knows? More elephant ear.
Look at this giant thistle.
It is something.
That is...
No, that's not a Canadian thistle. No. I don't know what kind of thistle it is, but it is huge. It hasn't gone to seed yet.
It won't.
It won't, but it is amazing. I mean, talk about your symmetry of leaves and stems coming out. That's perfect.
Well, and then your typical zinnia patch is now full of beautiful dahlias.
Dahlias, right. And I keep taking off the old ones, encouraging the other ones to come along. But it's almost a daily thing. You think you've got them all, and then you come out and there's another. Oh, that one's done now. So I think it was not yesterday, but the day before. All of these have been trimmed off that were done, and... needs to be done.
Look at all this milkweed.
Yes. Now...
Did we plant any?
No. We did not plant any of that milkweed. It came... They travel underground. And while these never had any flowers, they never had any monarchs on them, I think next year I'll just get them quickly and remove them, because we have others.
And then you have this again.
This is our helenium. Huge again.
I mean, stand next to it just for scale.
I mean, it comes up by itself. It's a perennial.
I mean, that is amazing. We were out here yesterday watching the bumblebees on here.
Yes.
But we didn't see any honeybees,
no,
which was kind of unusual.
Yep.
And I don't see anybody out here now.
No. Well, I think the weather took a cool turn, so that was that. Seem to have a lot of snapdragons around, which I love. These are the Peruvian daffodils that will have to be dug up. We put zinnias in containers this year. And again, I come out probably every other day and take off the old ones, because new ones will shoot up if you continue to do that.
You can't even see our sign anymore.
Nope. And it's not covered by snow either. More dahlias.
Yeah, they are impressive.
And this particular group, it was a multicolored group when I planted them, and those colors are amazing.
And the size too.
Yes.
This is probably one of the largest ones right there.
And then talk about the phlox, because those phlox have been outstanding this year as well. Phlox, real phlox, comes out this time of year, a little bit earlier. And again, it has 5 petals for the word phlox, P-H-L-O-X. Beautiful fragrance. This is a variegated variety. And this is just a plain green variety, but you see the flowers are exactly the same.
And even your honeysuckles are still going to town.
Yeah. Joe Pieweed is done. Again, that one didn't get as tall as it usually gets.
And I don't think we got any apples on either of our 2 apple trees over there.
Nope.
Now, we did have some apples growing in the orchard.
Yes. In fact, this morning I saw 2 Granny Smith on the ground, so I brought those in the house. The apples are growing this year. Most of them are Granny Smith, but we had a frost that pretty much took care of all but the Granny Smith apples, and we see 1 red one over there. And it seemed to have killed off all of the peach possibilities. So there are no peaches this year. But hopefully next year, the seasons will cooperate and we will have more fruit. We have our grapevines. We had some purple grapes over here that were very sweet, and the seeds were tiny.
Yeah, and I heard now the grapevine.
Right, and now the green ones, which I think are Niagaras, are getting ready. They're not quite...
Well, I know you brought in one pink cluster that was really tart.
It was the skin is tart. If you can get past that, you're okay.
Well, I hope you can make that nectar again sometime, because
that
was absolutely spectacular.
And I also noticed that we have a pumpkin that's growing. It's about this big, and it's very green yet, so I don't know if it's going to make it or not, but we'll see. If you enjoyed this video, I'm getting cold. I'm going to have to go in. I love being cold out here, because you can always put clothes on, but there's only so many you can take off. If you enjoyed the video, please give us a thumbs up. We'd appreciate that. And we love hearing your comments and questions and well wishes. Thank you so much for those. If you'd like to become part of our garden family, if you aren't already, there is a little orangey red button over here. And then there's a little bell up here that if you click on that, it'll notify you when a new video comes out. So in we go. Richard's going to rest, and I'm going to put on some heavier clothes. Bye for now.
Connect with us on YouTube and subscribe to our channel.